It's a great topic, as you can see on the screen, and we also have one of our own Rotarians presenting. Steve Burger, as you know, is chair of our great program committee. He's been a 45-year Rotarian at this club. In his other day job in the past, he's been 50 years with the gospel ministry mission, and then he also served as executive director of the association for 18 years. Quite a frequent trips to Washington, D.C., so we'd love to hear your stories about your great uncle. Steve?
But don't tell anybody. It's a secret. I'm sort of a PR guy. To tell nobody, they said, we are afraid for his security. I don't know how many alcoholics even know who the Chief Justice is. So I come to my mission, six-story building, 300 or 400 men sleeping there. And what does a mission look like on Sunday morning? Everybody is loafing around, right? I'm walking through checking to see how things look. I want it to look at its best. Everybody's wondering what this clown's doing here at this hour. So he arrived. We went on the tour. We're standing in a dormitory. 60 beds. They're now all in. 60 men slept there overnight, homeless men. On the bed of one of the men was a backpack and some other stuff, and I recognized it, and I said to my uncle, I said, that was a young man I talked to last night. He was in his 20s. And he's homeless, not much more. As we talked, my uncle began to cry. Tears ran down his cheeks. Now this is this tough old judge they tell you about. The one that always looks so stern. Crying like a baby. He says to me, Steve, remember, that's the way the Rockefellers came to the United States. They had nowhere to stay. He said, that's the way the Weyerhaeusers came. He said, that's the way your great-grandfather came. He said, never forget that. He said, somebody has to lend them a hand. Then he said, I wish I could tell the press what they're doing here. Why aren't they here? I said, they told me I had to keep it a secret. He said, we'll come back tomorrow and we'll tell everybody. He was there on behalf of a university that was opening a law school. And that afternoon they wanted to move. Well, I didn't know what was happening, and I got this call. He's having a press conference in the chapel of a rescue mission at 10 o'clock the next morning. But I get a call from the college. They want to move it to the college. They don't think he ought to be on State Road. Absolutely not. I said, you need to talk to him. I think he's been very clear. But I didn't know what he was going to do. But now we're having a press conference, so I show up. Plenty of time, try to get everything arranged. I see a limo coming down the street. He parks in front of the Salvation Army. Poor rescue mission guy, that's a little hard. That's a block up the street. And he says, I go up, I say, don't warn, we got a spot saved for you right in front of our mission. He says, Steve, in that dark tone, Steve, I've learned how to make a grand entry. He says, if I get out of that car down there, they'll say Chief Justice stumbles on the skid road. He said, let me show you how it's done. And he took me by the arm and we marched down 2nd Avenue. Picture of us coming under the mission sign appeared in newspapers all over the world. I got a copy from a friend that was in Nigeria. Chief Justice visits the poor on Skid Road in Seattle. So we entered the chapel. We had it all set up in the front, but he saw the gospel sign was on the wall. He said, I'd rather be under the preaching, he said. And we moved. When we got done, one of the reporters at the first news conference he's had in 2 years. Maybe more than that, because he didn't have news conferences. He didn't believe that's what he was supposed to do. So the reporter started, he said, "Well, I have a question. Should Steve tell them what you do here?" And as they then he answered all their questions, and then they asked him this question. They said, "If you're are you endorsing this rescue mission?" He said, "I only endorse two things." He said, "The scholarship program for the Bar Association and the Historic Society of the Supreme Court. But if my visit here, does this mission some good?" He said, "Hallelujah." For a Presbyterian to say hallelujah out loud, that's pretty moving in itself. Now what I want you to feel is a heart. See, always see somebody in a black robe. I want you to feel a heart. I want you to feel someone that grew up with nothing, 7 kids, in a family with an alcoholic father. One of the newspapers I read, it said my grandfather was a traveling salesman. And I laughed about that because I understand he traveled a lot from Salvation Army to rescue missions to places like that. He didn't do well. 7 kids. Said the paper, he had 6 paper routes, and my dad said he never said who actually delivered the papers, he did. One other story that brings this, what I think, to the human part. I was 90 miles away when it was named Chief Justice. I was director of the Little York Rescue Mission in York, Pennsylvania, and we got to go to the celebration. So following the celebration, the intimate party on his lawn, 200 to 300 of the big shots. Us little Minnesota delegation standing over here by ourselves, looking at who's going by. There goes John Glenn. There goes Kennedy. There goes one. All of a sudden, I get a tap on my shoulder. It's my uncle. He said, "Steve, I've been looking for you." "Yeah, sure, you betcha." It's his biggest day in his life. He says he's looking for me. He said, "Come with me." What do you do then? You go, right? So I went. And he takes me to a group of people. The only one I can tell for sure I remember was the general head of the United States Air Force, because he was dressed appropriately. He said, "I wanted you to meet the most important person in our family, my nephew Steve, who works with the poor." You know, I had a problem when I went from working with inner city kids to alcoholics. My father said, "You've done so many darn stupid things already, what's one more?" You know, in the proper position, right? So when people ask me what I did when I worked with kids, I always talked about the youth center, not that it was run by a rescue mission. Now I'm running a rescue mission. I got no cover. And here I'm standing there, he said, "My nephew runs a rescue mission. He does the most important thing in our family. He works with the poor." Never again was I ashamed of what I did. Never again. He had lifted me up. And that's the kind of person he was. He was a person that had deep care for others. One of the things that I learned was he was hard to convince, okay, but he listened. I told him I had met a man who I thought he ought to know. The fellow's name was Chuck Colson. Colson went to jail. He was the one that said that, that he'd run over his grandmother for Richard Nixon, if you remember. And in the process of going to jail, he made a full commitment of his life to Christ and started prison fellowship. They both had the same views on prison reform. These two guys need to be together, right? So I said to my uncle, I'd like you to meet Chuck Colson. He said, I don't believe in those jailhouse conversions. End of story, right? So I sent him Colson's books. I don't know if that worked or not, I tried. So I get a call. Again, he starts in the middle of the conversation. He said, I met your friend. He's out in Florida with Jack Eckhart, the drug guy, drugstore guy. You know, keep it straight these days. He said, and I met. Eckhart said, come with me. Where are we going? He said, I've got Chuck Colson speaking. I want you to hear him. He said, I would not have gone. He said, but you convinced me that I ought to hear this man. And he said, I've changed my opinion. We're working together on prison reform. Now, I would say, and now we're going to start talking about the things I learned on the porch, but I want to tell you that he believed that you could disagree and be agreeable. What a change we had happen. He also told me who his best friend was. His best friend was a guy he debated on Minnesota radio in 1948, a fellow named Humphrey, Hubert H. And he said he learned that Humphrey could talk a long time about nothing as well as about something. So he said, I waited until there's 30 seconds left, and I listed all the Truman people who were in jail. He said, Humphrey got mad. He said it lasted 30 seconds. Then we went out and had coffee. The difference. And he told me, he said, I was having dinner with Dwayne Andreessen, who was the president of the Archer Daniel Midland ADM company, who had become the treasurer of the celebration of the Constitution. And my uncle said, he said this to me, do you know what Hubert Humphrey had to do with your nomination? He said, no, I have no idea. He said, I was having dinner with Thomas Dewey in New York at the Athletic Club, and Nixon called to ask Dewey what he thought of Warren Burger for Chief Justice. He came back to the table and told me that, I asked him what he said. He said, I wouldn't touch him as a hot potato. He said, then I told Dewey, this is Andreessen, I told Dewey that Hubert Humphrey thought a lot of Warren Burger. He said, I'll tell him that. And Nixon called Hubert Humphrey. Hubert said, I won't say a word. The minute you announce it, I will grab a microphone and say, I'll lead in the confirmation of my friend, Warren Burger. Well, what's the change then that we are dealing with? Why are we doing what we're doing today? Well, I sat in his back porch and we talked about some of those changes. You know how long it took to get him confirmed from the time the first committee met and the Senate voted? 5 hours. 5 hours! Takes that a long time for the guy to get to the meetings now. It took 5 hours. I said, what's the change? He gave me one name, Robert Bork. He said, we assumed a Republican president would pick conservatives, a Democrat president would pick liberals, right? So we looked at qualifications, not very much at philosophy, because that's where we thought it would be. He said, but Bork changed all that. And with the Bork nomination, we made the first consideration in many times was the philosophy. Said something else as we were talking. He said, there's too many judges on the court. Well, who would you put on a court but judges? Too many judges, he said. The presidents want to see all, they now want to see all the credentials. They want to see all the credentials, all the rulings over the years. We've heard what he's had to do now as he's been going for the nomination. He said some of the greatest Supreme Court judges never served a day as a judge. Brandeis, Frankfurt, all kind, a number of people. He said, that's something we have lost. We lost because it brings in a different dimension. He also said, remember, just because you have the same basic philosophy doesn't mean you're great. I asked him one day, I said, have you ever wished you were on the court again? He said, only today. He said, the man that took my place, a fellow named Scalia, voted that you can burn the American flag. He said, now, here's two guys that have philosophy, right? Conservative. He said, if Burger had been there, they wouldn't be burning the American flag. Now, he said the court will fail when people can't stand up, raise the right hand, and tell the truth. He said our whole system is based on it. Now, I'm running out of time, so I can't do too much more here. But I asked him who was the smartest person that he served with. He said, no question. He says, smart and right aren't the same things. Who is the most compassionate? Jimmy Carter. He said, those were real tears. Who got the most done of what he said? You mean of what he said in the movie? Ronald Reagan. And then he told me, he said, I was turning in the stuff from the Bi-Centennial. Just the middle bureaucrats in the White House. And in turning it in, there was a murmur in the room. And I looked up, and it was President Clinton. He said, I got to get up. He said, no, Mr. Chief Justice, you stay seated. I came here to welcome you to the White House. I've admired you all these years, and I wanted to welcome you. He said, I didn't know what to do, he said, but then Clinton said, we're just two poor Midwestern boys that made it. Mama said, I never thought of Arkansas in the Middle West. But he said, when he got done, I was convinced. He said, I never met somebody in so short a period of time who could make you feel like you had known them all your life. You can't forget people who have walked among us and leave a shadow. To me, I want to walk in those footprints. Remembering not just somebody who gave out law, but somebody who lived it before us all. Thank you very much.
Presentation today. And I know we're going to not have the Q&A because I'm not sure a member. I'm sure we'll
returns. We'll follow up with you separately if they have any more questions about your terrific uncle. So I want to present you with our Rotary Bug for your presentation today.